India, one of the oldest civilizations in the world and one of the youngest nations. In just 75 years of its independence from colonial rule, the country has seen an unparalleled pace of progress. On this Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav, we celebrate India, how we eat and pray, balance modernity with tradition, how we nurture science and protect our ancient forests, how we tell millions of stories on the big screen, from languages and spices to IT powerhouses and space travel, from ancient philosophy and ways of living to modern cinema and environmental conservation. The world has always looked to India. The journey of India is like no other. India is the land of the spiritual, the divine. Where millions find their own paths to enlightenment. Our ancient traditions hum the songs of different faiths. Each a strain converging in a holy hymn. Pilgrims may take different routes to reach their sacred spaces. Yet, they all find the light that touches their souls. India is where we bring the gods home, where our devotion moves us to tears, where we pray shoulder to shoulder with many or commune with our own faith alone. Rivers older than time reflect our prayers. The holy mountains echo with our humble chanting. Our rituals connect us to the past and the future. We understand the intertwining of the body and the soul. We raise our eyes to the heavens with our feet firmly grasping our sacred soil. Our faith uplifts us and grounds us. We seek, we pray, we give thanks in 100 ways and reach a sense of oneness. On the journey of India, you will see how the divine light, shot through the prism of India, is a kaleidoscope of spirituality and faith.
The essence of India's ethos is spiritual. Everything is worshipped. Worshipping the river, worshipping the earth, trees are worshipped, mountains are worshipped, even the sea is worshipped. So, where does it come from? It comes from our ethos, where we believe that there is one supreme reality whose sparks are scattered into every heart.
Bharat is the original name of the country. Bharat means the one who brings us from darkness into light. Bharat, as a country, is very rich in the science of the inner world, which means the science of thoughts, the science of feelings, the science of sanskar.
75 years ago, many predicted that India's diversity would be a stumbling block. Instead, it became a foundation stone. Independent India continues its tradition of being a vibrant, thriving melting pot where all our religions, customs, and cultures don't just coexist, they flourish. Our tradition of respecting all faiths is what attracts the faithful to us. How we choose to seek is individual. What we seek is universal. I'm Amish, an author, a Lord Shiva devotee, and a spiritual seeker. My lessons in our culture, traditions, and history were learned from my late grandfather, Pandit Babulal Tripathi. He was a teacher at Banaras Hindu University. I still remember he would take all of us, his grandchildren, to the banks of the Ganga River, carrying the Ramayana with him. He would sit down there, read a few pages, and explain it. He used to say that anyone who has been blessed with knowledge has a duty to share it as widely as possible. And what better place to share knowledge than the banks of the Ganga? In a country of sacred rivers, the Ganga is the most sacred of them all. The cycles of birth, life, and death are commemorated along the banks of this great river. And what can be more sacred than the glacial source of the Ganga? At a height of 3,500 meters, spread across 30 icy kilometers, the Gangotri is one of the largest glaciers in the Himalayan region and also one of the most sacred pilgrimage spots. There are three other pilgrimage spots close by, the Yamunotri, Kedarnath and Badrinath. Together, they make up the Chota Char Dham, or the four smaller pilgrimage abodes. At 12,000 feet above sea level, a 14-kilometer trek to a 1,200-year-old temple dedicated to Lord Shiva, a pilgrimage to Kedarnath is a physically and mentally daunting task for anyone. But for one whose life has already presented incredible challenges, a pilgrimage to Kedarnath elevates him beyond the ordinary. It gives him a new lease of life.
My name is Rajendra Singh Tamar. We have served 11 years in the army. केदारनाथ जाना मैंने 2015 में शुरू किया। भगवान भोलेनाथ एक शक्ति है, ईश्वर है जो अब संसार का भरण पोषण करते हैं और मेरे लिए तो इष्ट है मेरा। आर्टिफिशियल प्रोसेस के साथ में यात्रा करना थोड़ा सा डिफिकल्ट होता है, लेकिन आर्मी बैकग्राउंड से तो थोड़ा सा स्ट्रॉन्ग तो है ही। भगवान शिव कैलाश पर्वत में विराजमान रहते हैं, तो ये जो हिमालयन बेल्ट है, कैलाश पर्वत की बेल्ट, इसलिए भी महत्वपूर्ण हो जाता है कि हम इन स्थानों पर आकर के उनका दर्शन कर अपने आप को कृतार्थ करें। जब आप भगवान शिव का दर्शन करते हैं तो एक वातावरण क्रिएट होता है कि आपको आत्मसंतुष्टि मिलती है, आत्मा की शांति मिलती है, एक सुकून मिलता है दिल को कि आज हमने आकर के यहाँ पे कुछ किया है या पाया है। और 99 में की लड़ाई में कारगिल वार में जब वॉन्डेड हुए तो उसके बाद में वॉन्डेड आउट होकर के घर आ गए। आप कह सकते हैं कि मैं एक तरह से जीरो पे आ गया था। वैसे विश्वास पे जिंदगी चलती है हमारी। अब ये ईश्वरीय शक्ति मान लीजिए या भगवान भोलेनाथ और माँ भवानी का आशीर्वाद मान लीजिए कि मेरी जिंदगी में बदलाव आए। शब्दों में इसको बयान करना थोड़ा सा मुश्किल है, लेकिन क्या है कि अपने आराध्य को जो पूजते हैं तो आप ये मान लीजिए कि अगर पूजा करते हुए आपकी आंखों में अगर आंसू आ गए तो इट मींस वी आर सक्सेस।
अ पिलग्रिमेज मे अपीयर लाइक अ पर्सनल एंडेवर, बट पिलग्रिम्स एंड द ट्रैवलिंग फेथफुल क्रिएट अ रिपल इफेक्ट एज दे मूव। सो व्हाइल सम पिलग्रिम्स मे हैव अ सेक्रेट डेस्टिनेशन to reach, for other pilgrims, preaching their faith is the sole purpose of their journey.
I love India. This is a land of Shakyamuni Buddha. Thanks to Shakyamuni Buddha, Buddhism come from India to Japan, so I became a Buddhist. 6 years ago, I started to stay here. Bodh Gaya is a very holy place for us. You can say the beginning of Buddhism.
Previously, it was known as Uruvela, in the banks of the river Niranjana. The Bodhi tree is important here. It is under this tree where Siddhartha attained enlightenment. So after that, this place is known as Bodh Gaya, and now we call it Buddha Gaya. The Buddha found a path to ease human life, to be happy.
Our normal life, we have lots of difficulty, but the answer is inside the Buddhist scripture. So if I study, if I try to practice, I can get my answer. We should preserve his teaching and we should hand over next generation.
India's philosophical and religious teachings have shaped the world since time immemorial. From Sri Lanka to Cambodia to Indonesia, our beliefs transcend borders. As Buddhist messengers once took the message to different parts of the world, today that very message brings travelers back to India.
In today's date, we have so many temples here. You can call Bodh Gaya as a mini United Nations. People come in large numbers throughout the year.
My Guruji always said, without Buddha sight calling me, I cannot be here. My wish is staying forever until die.
So is my wish also. I'm here 40 years now. My home, everything is here in Bodh Gaya. I sit in silence and pray for my wish to come true. So I wait for that day.
To find balance through the renunciation of the material world and family life, as Gautam Buddha did, is one path to enlightenment. But India's various faiths means an awareness of other paths. Take Ardha Nareshwar, a form of Lord Shiva that is a union of the divine feminine and masculine. One cannot exist without the other. Shiva without Shakti is Shava. The divine masculine without the divine feminine is lifeless. At the Meenakshi Temple in southern India, it is this union between Shakti and Shiva, or Meenakshi and Sundareshwar as they are known here, that is celebrated as Tirukalyanam, or the celestial wedding.
The center of everything is Meenakshi Temple. All roads lead to Meenakshi. The power of Meenakshi can't be described. It has to be experienced. This temple was consecrated by the Pandyas, and later the structure which you see today was completed by the Nayak kings about 600 to 700 years ago.
Madurai is unique for its Dravidian architecture, and especially because of the tall, high gopuras.
The gopurams, as you see them, is a tribute to the engineering skills of our forefathers. And they are very good examples of the Tamilian capability and art. Meenakshi, again, is Shiva and Shakti worship, which is there across the country. Meenakshi comes as the form of Parvati, and Lord Sundareshwara as Shiva.
Here, the main deity is not Sundareshwara, it is Meenakshi only.
Legend has it that Arimartha Pandya king did not have any children. He did a yaga, and therefrom emerged a girl child.
By birth, she was called as Tadatakai, because she had triple breast. When she has been coronated as the queen of Madurai, she takes a Digvijaya and wins over all the land and finally lands up in Kailasha. At Kailasha, she meets her would-be husband, Shiva. On the first sight of Shiva, she understands her identity. Then after, she is called as Meenakshi. And then after, the marriage takes place.
The celestial wedding is known as Thirukalyanam in Tamil.
When Meenakshi Kalyanam happens in Madurai, the whole of Madurai and the surrounding villages are as if the marriage is happening at their own home. It's not happening in the temple. Every woman in this region would love to take part in the marriage.
At the very moment when Meenakshi Thirukalyanam takes place, they'll be removing their Mangal Sutra and putting a new Mangal Sutra. This is one of the very unique features of the Hindu philosophy and Hindu worship, where the lives of gods and lives of humans are perfectly aligned. The belief here, the legend here is, Meenakshi answers to the call of her devotees. That is the belief and that's the power which attracts millions and millions of people here and keeps this temple going. We do have peoples of other religions coming into this temple. There are any number of foreigners who have taken Diksha and they visit temples with all Rudraksh. So faith is a unifier without any doubt.
The unifying power of faith, as seen through Goddess Meenakshi, flows through other religions in India as well. Sikhism is based on the dissolution of superficial differences of caste, race, or gender. This dissolution is achieved through one simple instruction. Through simple service, eternal peace is obtained. Seva or service is one of the main tenets of Sikhism, a religion founded by Guru Nanak Dev in the late 15th century. According to the Janam Sakhis or life stories of Guru Nanak, he meditated and found enlightenment in Sultanpur Lodhi. Legends say that he then travelled on foot to spread his philosophy, Miri Piri, Mir, which means temporal power, balanced by Pir, spiritual authority. It is believed further that he travelled for the next 25 years in journeys called Udasis, continuing to spread his philosophy.
ਸੁਲਤਾਨਪੁਰ ਲੋਧੀ ਦੀ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਪਵਿੱਤਰ ਧਰਤੀ ਆ ਜਿਸ ਵੇਲੇ ਸਤਿਗੁਰ ਜੀ ਨੇ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਮੂਲ ਮੰਤਰ ਦੀ ਬਖਸ਼ਿਸ਼ ਕੀਤੀ ਪਹਿਲਾਂ ਅਕਾਲ ਪੁਰਖ ਦੀ ਰਚਨਾ ਨੂੰ ਇੱਕ ਕਹਿਣਾ ਉਹ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਧਰਮ ਦੀ ਕਿਰਤ ਕਰਨੀ ਉਹ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਦੱਬੇ ਲਤਾੜੇ ਲੋਕਾਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚੋਂ ਇੱਕ ਮਨੁੱਖ ਨੂੰ ਚੁਣਨਾ ਔਰ ਉੱਥੇ ਸਤਿਗੁਰ ਜੀ ਨੇ ਸਾਰਾ ਸਿੱਖ ਧਰਮ ਦਾ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਉਹ ਭਾਵੇਂ ਪ੍ਰਕਾਸ਼ਮਾਨ ਸਤਿਗੁਰੂ ਜੀ ਪਹਿਲਾਂ ਹੋ ਗਿਆ ਪਰ ਉਹਦੀ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਸ਼ੁਰੂਆਤ ਸਤਿਗੁਰੂ ਜੀ ਨੇ ਫਿਰ ਉੱਥੇ ਬਖਸ਼ਿਸ਼ ਕੀਤੀ ਸੋਲ੍ਹਾਂ 'ਚ ਚਾਰ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਸਤਿਗੁਰੂ ਜੀ ਨੇ ਪ੍ਰਕਾਸ਼ਮਾਨ ਕੀਤੇ ਆਦਿ ਸ਼੍ਰੀ ਗੁਰੂ ਗ੍ਰੰਥ ਸਾਹਿਬ ਦੀ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਪਵਿੱਤਰ ਸਰੋਵਰ ਦੀ ਰਚਨਾ ਸਤਿਗੁਰੂ ਜੀ ਨੇ ਕੀਤੀ ਉਸ ਪਵਿੱਤਰ ਸਰੋਵਰ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਕੋਈ ਕਾਸਟ ਕ੍ਰੀਡ ਦਾ ਕੋਈ ਮਸਲਾ ਨਹੀਂ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਮਰਜ਼ੀ ਜਾ ਕੇ ਉੱਥੇ ਇਸ਼ਨਾਨ ਕਰ ਸਕਦਾ
He finally settled down in Kartarpur, which is in present-day Pakistan, a site that is holy to Sikhs from around the world and those on both sides of the border too. Kartarpur is yet another example of the unifying power of faith.
ਅਤੇ ਮੈਂ ਸਮਝਦਾ ਇੱਕ ਵੱਡੀ ਉਪਲਬਧੀ ਸੀ ਕਰਤਾਰਪੁਰ ਦੀ ਧਰਤੀ ਦਾ ਲਾਂਘਾ ਖੋਲ੍ਹਣਾ ਸੈਂਟਰ ਦੀ ਸਰਕਾਰ ਇਸ ਗੱਲੋਂ ਵਧਾਈ ਦੀ ਪਾਤਰ ਆ ਵੀ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੇ ਇਸ ਅਸਥਾਨ ਨੂੰ ਲਾਂਘਾ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਸੀ ਉਹ ਖੋਲ੍ਹ ਦਿੱਤਾ। ਅੱਜ ਸਿੱਖ ਉੱਥੋਂ 12-14 ਘੰਟਿਆਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਦਰਸ਼ਨ ਦਰਦਾਰੇ ਕਰਕੇ ਵਾਪਸ ਮੁੜ ਆਉਂਦਾ। ਸਤਿਗੁਰਾਂ ਜੀ ਦੇ 1469 ਤੋਂ ਲਾਈਏ ਤਾਂ ਆਪਾਂ ਅੱਜ 2022 ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਆ ਗਏ ਹਾਂ। ਆਪਾਂ ਦੋ ਤਰ੍ਹਾਂ ਦੀ ਦੁਨੀਆ ਕਹਿੰਦੇ, ਲੋਕ ਅਤੇ ਪਰਲੋਕ। ਲੋਕ ਤਾਂ ਆਪਾਂ ਵੱਸਦੇ ਹਾਂ, ਸਾਰੇ ਦੇਖਦੇ ਹਾਂ, ਅਤੇ ਪਰਲੋਕ ਕਿਸੇ ਨੇ ਦੇਖਿਆ ਨਹੀਂ। ਕਿਉਂ? ਪਰ ਸਤਿਗੁਰੂ ਜੀ ਕਹਿੰਦੇ, ਮੈਂ ਤੇਰੀ ਗਰੰਟੀ ਕਰਦਾ, ਤੂੰ ਗੁਰੂ ਆਸ਼ੇ ਅਨੁਸਾਰ ਜ਼ਿੰਦਗੀ ਨੂੰ ਜੀ ਅਤੇ ਤੈਨੂੰ ਮੈਂ ਉਤਲਾ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਉਹ ਵੀ ਵਧੀਆ ਦਿਖਾ ਦੂੰਗਾ ਅਤੇ ਉਹ ਵਧੀਆ ਹੁੰਦਾ ਆ।
ਦ ਜਰਨੀ ਟੂਅਰਡਸ ਟਰੂਥ ਕੈਨ ਓਨਲੀ ਬੀ ਟੇਕਨ ਐਜ਼ ਐਨ ਇੰਡੀਵਿਜੁਅਲ, ਬਟ ਦ ਸਪਰੈਡ ਆਫ ਦੈਟ ਟਰੂਥ ਹੈਪਨਸ ਥਰੂ ਕਨਵਰਸੇਸ਼ਨਸ ਬਿਟਵੀਨ ਦੀ ਐਨਲਾਈਟਨਡ ਐਂਡ ਦ ਸੀਕਰ, ਐਂਡ ਦੈਨ ਫਰੋਮ ਵਨ ਸੀਕਰ ਟੂ ਦ ਨੈਕਸਟ। Whether in ancient times or modern, whether through words and stories or modern technology, faith is often spread through the faithful. And when the going gets tough, it is these pillars of faith that the faithful lean on to find strength. In Islam, the five pillars are the profession of faith, giving alms, prayer, pilgrimage, and fasting. Fasting is an act of worship and of learning compassion for the less fortunate. After the month of Ramzan, Eid al-Fitr is celebrated as a day of gratitude. Whether it is the meditative experience of fasting or the exploration of self through faith, these are lessons worth sharing. We meet a family in Delhi that is sharing these lessons in different ways.
Religion is a process of self-discovery. It is not something which is to be imposed on you. You're not to be told, do this, don't do that. You have to discover that yourself. And this was a revolutionary idea for me. And therefore I started to study Islam more deeply, and I thought that I should share these ideas with people. Islam speaks a lot about how you have to lead your life with wisdom. Your daily life has to be spent not unmindfully. You have to live mindfully, thoughtfully. My grandfather has been a great inspiration to me. And the entire family is devoted to studying the legacy that my grandfather has left behind and carry it forward.
My father, Maulana Wahiduddin Khan, was an Islamic scholar and a spiritual teacher. His focus was on spirituality. And I remember that my father would send me to a library. So I used to go there, and there was a very nice library called Children's Library. So I would sit there and flip through the pages. Prophet ne kaha tha ke wisdom is the lost property of the believer. Wherever he finds it, he takes it.
You begin the day of Eid with prayer, because after the entire month of fasting, you have discovered how blessed you are. So you rediscover the blessings of God that you're immersed in on the day of Eid, and prayer is an expression of that rediscovery. We have a tradition in our family. Our father leads the prayer. The entire family stands behind him in rows.
After the prayer, we sit and then we discuss what lessons we have received, we have imbibed from the Quran.
Deep within, following Islam means to me connecting with God Almighty, connecting with the Creator. There has to be something that I associate with, something that transcends me, something that goes beyond me, something larger and deeper. So I find that meaning or that deeper purpose in my connection with God, in establishing a bond with God Almighty.
For many, their faith in essence is a path to spirituality, an acknowledgement of something greater than the self, a link to the cosmic, the divine. For them, spirituality is a path to truly understanding and following their faith with absolute freedom. And where could this be more apparent than the land of music and laughter, a melting pot of myriad cultures and beliefs, Goa?
If there's religion but no spirituality, it's useless. But if you're spiritual, then you can choose whatever religious path you want. That will enhance your spirituality. It's all about giving. Every religion has music, right? That's a way of swaying and getting closer to God. We are a Catholic family here, living here in Goa. We grew up in a Catholic society. The church would continuously have religious functions. Music became a very integral part of our lives because of playing in the choir. You're used to a certain routine as a Catholic. When I met Shruti, we started diversifying. She's a Saraswat Brahmin. I started getting exposed to another thought process. You start analyzing those things that you did in the past. And now I won't say you stop doing it, but you start doing it more practically. So if I have to go to church and I feel that there's somebody in need, I will stop. I will take care of that person and not and miss out on my church. There are a whole lot of Hindu festivals, whole lot of Catholic festivals. We've been celebrating both. So in fact, we've added to our fun quotient in our life than we were as individuals. There are two places of worship in our house. There is a Mother Mary statue inside that temple. In Goa itself, this is what happens. There's always been religious harmony over here. People do participate in each other's religious festivities. For them, it is something that's related to their village. It doesn't matter which religion it belongs to. Jesus was not just a death. Jesus was a sacrifice. If Jesus had not resurrected, then we would not have had the sink between divinity and humanity. So Easter is very important. After Mass, everybody would come to my house. So we celebrate. Music is something that relates to your soul. It comes from inside you. If you're pure, if you're good, I think whatever you do, your music will sound good. It's more important that you be a good human being. Spirituality, then comes religion.
Celebration is intertwined with faith. For some, a period of abstinence ends with color, music, and a feast. For others, a journey of intense renunciation begins with joyous festivities, like in this small town in Western India.
मैं द्रव्य संसार से जुड़ी हुई हूँ और कल जैसे ही रजोरन मिलेगा ना तो जितने द्रव्य हैं ना ये सारे द्रव्य छूट जाएंगे और एकदम सिंपल लाइफ चालू हो जाएगी। तो बस दीक्षा का महत्व यही है कि खुद की आत्मा का कल्याण करना है और परमानेंट सुख चाहिए। तो इसलिए ये सारा छोड़कर अपने को मोक्ष में जाना है। अपनी आत्मा में एक भी अवगुण नहीं रहेगा, एक भी अवगुण नहीं रहेगा ना, तब जाकर हमको मोक्ष की प्राप्ति होगी।
Renunciation actually means to give up the weakness within me, to give up the negative habits in me, to give up those sanskars which are not healthy for me.
यहाँ मेरी दीक्षा हो रही है तो यहाँ का संग मुझे विदाई देगा, पूरा संग मेरा माता पिता होगा।
हमारा सबसे बड़ा अल्टीमेट गोल है पीस, हैप्पीनेस एंड लव। देयरफॉर दिस लाइफ इज फॉर हैप्पीनेस।
जैनिज्म इज द ओनली रिलीजन व्हिच हैज गिवन अ लॉट ऑफ इंपॉर्टेंस टू नन्स in its, as renunciants. And they do believe that somewhere it causes a lot of attachment to things. And Diksha is detach yourself from it.
Like with Diksha, the liberation of the self from material desires is especially resonant with followers of the ISKCON movement, also known as Krishna Consciousness or the Hare Krishna movement, was started to spread the love for Lord Krishna.
Just like electric bulb was invented in America, but its use is there for people across the world. So similarly, the message of the Gita, the message of Sanatan Dharma is so important that it must be spread across the whole world. At the age of 70, His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada, on the instruction of his guru, went to the West, and in 1966 he established International Society for Krishna Consciousness in New York City. Today, ISKCON has 750 temples across the whole world, with 120 restaurants and 80 farm communities. The Bhagavad Gita as it is was published by Srila Prabhupada in the early 70s. It has been translated in more than 80-85 languages and distributed across the world in more than 500 million copies. Krishna reveals to Arjuna the relationship between the Supreme Soul and the soul is that of service by the soul to the Supreme Soul, to please Him and to love Him. That eternal relationship is known as Sanatan Dharma. Within the Vaishnava tradition, those who are part of ISKCON, they express this statement that I am interested in a relationship with you, Krishna, and I want to serve you and please you by saying Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. So, if you don't know the context, it may appear esoteric. But this is how, for thousands of years, devotees of Krishna have sent a friend request to Him. Hare Krishna,
Krishna Krishna. With the musical instruments and with the group of devotees, it just creates such a powerful form of meditation. It's just a wonderful way to connect with Krishna.
There is a sense of timelessness to Hindu temples. Each is unique and also universal. The recently inaugurated Kashi Vishwanath corridor connects the various ghats of the Ganga to the Kashi Vishwanath Dham. The cultural rejuvenation of the ancient Kashi Vishwanath temple was completed to facilitate millions of devotees in the coming years. The Swami Narayan Akshardham Mandir in New Delhi was built in accordance with the Shilpa Shastras, or the scriptures that prescribe the rules for arts and architecture of temples. With 9 domes, 20 spires, 234 ornate pillars, and 20,000 statues, the mandir is truly breathtaking. and across the seas in London, UK. A mandir built less than 40 years ago resonates with the same spirituality. The Swami Narayan Temple in London is the largest Hindu temple outside of India. It doesn't just conform to the Shilpa Shastras, it adheres to all of the UK's strict building codes as well. Today, these massive, magnificent temples are beacons for members of all faiths. Spirituality is part of the fabric of our lives in India. We infuse our beliefs into our ways of living. And there's no better example of this than yoga.
Yoga is the science of preparing the body by deconditioning it, decluttering it, to receive that which is beyond the capacity of the sense organs to explore. To say that the supreme, all-pervading truth, a part of it is in me, theoretically I can say it. But if I need to experience it, this vehicle called the body has to be prepared. It cannot receive otherwise.
Yoga was first mentioned in the Rig Veda many thousands of years ago. And some millennia after that, in the early years of the Common Era, sage Patanjali accumulated the vast knowledge of the Vedic rishis and taught yoga as we know it today. Every asana in yoga is based on an aspect of nature, flora and fauna. For example, the lotus pose is for detachment, inspired by the way water rolls off the petals of a lotus. Today, millions across the globe practice yoga. Its truth is undeniable.
योग की जो तस्वीरें कुछ वर्ष पहले केवल घरों में आध्यात्मिक केंद्रों में दिखती थी वो आज विश्व के कोने कोने से आ रही है। योग किसी व्यक्ति मात्र के लिए नहीं संपूर्ण मानवता के लिए है।
इंडिया इन टर्न रिकॉग्नाइजेस ट्रू योगीज फ्रॉम अक्रॉस द वर्ल्ड like Nauf Marwai, who founded the Arab Yoga Foundation in Jeddah, Saudi Arabia, which teaches yoga across the Arab world. Saudi Arabia celebrates the Yoga Day as well. Nauf Marwai was awarded the Padma Shri in 2018. A way of living well, inside and out, yoga is one of India's most precious gifts to humanity at large. The worship of nature is common to all ancient civilizations. Nature wasn't seen as a resource to be exploited, but as a divine being to be respected, worshipped, and given thanks to. Just as yogis pay respect to the sun through the Surya Namaskar, Zoroastrianism, more than 4,000 years old, has environmental consciousness at its core. Udwada in Gujarat is home to a large Parsi community, and Nowroz, the Parsi New Year, is celebrated with a lot of warmth here.
While praying, you get positive vibes, positive energy, direct connection to God. And that helps you in daily life, while doing anything in life, even speaking. Good words, good thoughts, good deeds. In Parsi, it's called Humakta Hukta Hurvarashtra. My name is Mafreen Bomi Gandhi. I live in a joint family. I'm from a small village, Regama. It's in Gujarat. And I'm a Zoroastrian.
We are all nature worshippers. We revere all the fire elements, like the sun, the moon, the stars, the water, the air. But the fire comes as a major and important dominance. Fire is supposed to be a creation without which one cannot survive. Nirancha is the oldest fire temple in India. Fire in this temple is burning perpetually since last 1300 years. So Udwada for Parsis is just like a Makkah for Muslims or a Vatican for Christians.
Church
There are certain prayers for the Parsi which has to be done at least 2 times in a day, morning and night.
We have to untie our kasti and then tie it back with our prayers.
The sadra and kusti is like an armor and a guard to us.
My grandfather, 2021, he passed away due to COVID. The last time I talked to him, like on the phone call, at least God gave me one chance to speak to him. But then we couldn't meet. So, it's okay. Then my mom made me understand that one day I will also go. You will also go. It's a life circle. Who has come down on earth, they have to go. The priests, they give us something called Yathatari Madad Saroshtari Pana. That prayer, that chant, that mantra helped me. And that gave me the strength to go ahead.
A fate is such a thing. Fate moves mountain.
We all know that India is a diverse country. When you're surrounded by people of different faiths, you get to share your faith with others. You get to learn from their faith.
I must quote Swami Vivekananda. He said, from my understanding, every living being, of course human being also, has a spark of the divine in them. If I have, the other guy also has. Therefore, no matter what externals are, if we have the same spark, we are all equal.
A country is not just about a population of people, it's about a collective vibration. What's our mindset? What's our sanskar? What's our vibration? That's the energy of the country. And the higher our vibration goes, the more we will be able to empower the world. So the power to empower the world comes from our collective vibrations.
What has grown in the last 75 years is people's awareness how India was a spiritual superpower and is still a spiritual superpower and how we need to reconnect with that power.
It is this faith that allows us to perceive what lies beyond our human senses. Sight, taste, touch, smell, elevated by the ways in which we worship. The sounds of our individual prayers uniting all our journeys into one song, bringing us peace.